Making global value chains work for development. Daria Taglioni and Deborah Winkler. This work is a product of the staff of the World Bank with external contributions. The findings, interpretations, and conclusions expressed in this work do not necessarily reflect the views of the World Bank, its board of executive directors, or the governments they represent. The World Bank does not guarantee the accuracy of the data included in this work. The boundaries, colors, denominations, and other information shown on any map in this work do not imply any judgment on the part of the World Bank concerning the legal status of any territory or the endorsement or acceptance of such boundaries. Nothing herein shall constitute or be considered to be a limitation upon or waiver of the privileges and immunities of the World Bank, all of which are specifically reserved. This work is available under the Creative Commons Attribution 3.0 AGO license, CC by 3.0 AGO, http://creativecommons.org/licenses-by-3.0-AGO. Under the Creative Commons Attribution license, you are free to copy, distribute, transmit, and adapt this work, including for commercial purposes, under the following conditions. Attribution. Please cite the work as follows. Daria Taglioni and Deborah Winkler, 2016. Making Global Value Chains Work for Development. Trade and Development Series. Washington, D.C. World Bank. DOI 10.1596978-1-4648-0157-0. License, Creative Commons Attribution CC by 3.0 AGO Adaptations. If you create an adaptation of this work, please add the following disclaimer along with the attribution. This is an adaptation of an original work by the World Bank. Views and opinions expressed in the adaptation are the sole responsibility of the author or authors of the adaptation and are not endorsed by the World Bank. Introduction. Making Global Value Chains Work for Development provides a framework, analytical tools, and policy options. The book shows why global value chains require fresh thinking. It presents a methodology for quantifying the extent of a country's participation in global value chains, based on available data. It also proposes a strategic framework to guide policymakers in identifying the key objectives of global value chain participation and development and in selecting suitable economic strategies to achieve them. Part 1. Why Global Value Chains Require Fresh Thinking. Part 1 begins by asserting that the economic implications of global value chains must be rethought for the 21st century. Global value chains entail four key features that set them apart from traditional production and trade. These are customization of production, sequential production decisions going from the buyer to the suppliers, high contracting costs, and global matching not only of goods and services, but also production teams and ideas, Antris 2015. Goods and services produced in global value chains are frequently customized to the needs of their intended buyers. Customization, in turn, entails sequential production and sales decisions that go from the final buyer backward to the producers of upstream inputs. Global production of customized goods and services also entails intensive contracting between parties, often subject to distinct legal systems. Because of the fragmented contracting environment, a significant share of global value chain trade is intra-firm. One note, 1. About 50% of total U.S. exports, for example, are intra-firm, according to Antris, 2015. Global value chains also lead to matching production teams globally, with unprecedented skill and knowledge transfer, but also with important distributional consequences. As world income shifts toward countries involved in global value chains and a superstar effect is generated in many countries, with the risk of growing inequalities domestically. Internationally fragmented production is not new. For decades, low and middle income countries have imported parts from countries with more advanced technology, but generally these imports were only for the assembly of locally sold goods. Because the goods produced were not part of the global network, flows of know-how and the rate of technology transfer were less intense. And because there were fewer opportunities to buy and sell on global markets, the push to improve productivity was also less strong. The new characteristic of global value chains from a development perspective is that factories in low- and middle-income countries have become full-fledged participants in international production networks, and this fact can present important development prospects. Low- and middle-income countries no longer are just importing parts for assembly for local sales, they are absorbing valuable foreign technology and know-how and importing inputs that they process and export in the form of goods, parts, components, and services used in some of the most sophisticated products today. Baldwin and Lopez-Gonzalez, 2013, call this process import to export, or I2E. Low- and middle-income countries no longer have to master the entire production process of a good. They can specialize in only a segment of the international production process while reaching sufficient production scale to meet their bottom line. Thanks to the access to global markets, as firms from different countries no longer just trade goods and services, but work together in vertically integrated systems of production, sharing blueprints, technicians, managerial practices, and productivity-enhancing tools and techniques, global value chains provide access to accelerated learning and transfer of tacit knowledge, at a rate unthinkable in a traditional trade setting. With global value chains, the range of actors in international trade and production has expanded. South-South trade flows and investment are rapidly gaining importance. Outward foreign direct investment by the BRICS, Brazil, the Russian Federation, India, China, and South Africa, rose from $7 billion U.S. dollars in 2000 to $145 billion U.S. dollars in 2012 and $200 billion U.S. dollars in 2013, that is, almost one-third of global foreign direct investment, Gomez Mera and others 2015. It is not just manufacturing. In countries such as India, the Philippines, and Vietnam, to name just a few, dynamic knowledge-intensive software and business services have emerged and are showing strong growth. And it is not just the story of large multinationals anymore. The fragmentation of production together with advances in information and communications technology are creating new entrepreneurial possibilities for small and medium enterprises to access markets abroad, giving rise to a new category of so-called micro-multinationals, which are small firms that develop global activities from their inception. Mettler and Williams 2011, participation is not a given but raises new challenges. Competition is fierce and low- and middle-income countries face a set of challenges to enter international production, upgrade to higher value-added products, tasks, and sectors, and ensure social upgrading and cohesion from participation. Countries are also faced with new policy trade-offs. High growth and development potential are associated with exposure to the increasing complexity and uncertainty that is associated with organizing production across several locations. Opening borders and attracting offshore factories is important, and those steps help jumpstart entry into global value chains. But retaining global value chains, maximizing their benefit to the domestic economy, and ensuring their sustainability require well-designed and well-targeted policies. From a policy perspective, the critical issue is how global value chains integrate into the economy as a whole. If global value chains remain delinked from the local context, lead firms will keep driving most decisions and governments may have limited influence and ability to leverage these decisions for domestic economic development. The policy challenge therefore extends to creating and strengthening links with domestic firms and ensuring that the host country benefits from technology transfers, knowledge spillovers, and increased value addition in the country. It is equally important to ensure that global value chain participation benefits domestic society through more and better paid jobs, better living conditions, and social cohesion. In a nutshell, the key question is, how can low- and middle-income countries make global value chains work for development? To exemplify how this book can help policymakers and answers to that challenge, Part 1 ends with a case study of Bulgaria. The study shows how analysts can make use of the quantitative tools described in Part 2 of the book, as well as the strategic policy framework developed in Part 3, to identify a country's position in global value chains. its scope for upgrading, and policies that can help achieve that goal. Finally, Part 4 closes the book, offering guidelines on how to design and implement a national strategy to achieve global value chain-led development. The guidelines are based on experience on the ground by World Bank Group teams. Part 2. Quantifying a country's position in global value chains. Integrating a country's domestic suppliers into global value chains increases the possibility for global value chain spillover through exporting to a buyer abroad or supplying to a multinational in the country. But countries should also consider from a buyer's perspective the opportunities that global value chain participation can provide. Firms can join existing global and regional value chains through importing parts and components that are used in production at home without the need to build a complete array of value chains at home. In the past, for a country to become an apparel exporter, for example, it would need design capabilities and textile mills. To export in the automotive sector, it would need to produce engines and all the subcomponents, and be able to produce on the scale necessary to compete with foreign producers. Under the new trade dynamics, a country can specialize in certain activities, for example, sewing, specific components, or sub-assemblies, and import the balance of manufacturing needs. Although such a situation does not guarantee significant value capture and upgrading from inception, it does provide a vital first step toward producing world-class, high-quality goods and services. Nowhere is that more evident than in China, and more widely across East Asia, where global value chains are at the heart of the open economy growth model that has been responsible for the growth and poverty reduction success story of the region in recent decades. Quantitative measures of global value chain participation and guidelines for analysis make it possible to deliver informed policy suggestions, correct identification of constraints and remedial actions, and assessment of the efficacy of new policy measures cut across the gamut of the statistical information system, including macro and, crucially, micro, firm-level, data. The organizing framework and indicators in Part 2 make it possible to answer questions related to a country's global value chain participation and the economic and social gains from such participation. The key takeaway from Part 2 is that a sound analysis of countries' participation in global value chains requires assessing performance across a wide range of indicators and concepts. No single measure or concept can be used to determine success or failure in global value chain integration. The development of value-added trade data represents a fundamental step forward in understanding global value chain trade. Nevertheless, currently, measures of global value chain participation and domestic value added in trade are not widely available. Existing global value chain databases are presented at a fairly aggregated level of goods and services, and do not always cover low- and middle-income countries. No single database in isolation provides a complete picture of global value chain participation and how much value added in trade is being generated domestically. By shifting emphasis from the broad country level to an increased focus on firms and narrowly defined sectors, Part 2 suggests moving further in the direction of better measures of global value chain participation and domestic value added embodied in trade. Questions that can be addressed with the tools described in Part 2 include the following: how extensive is a country's or sector's global value chain participation? What is a country's, sector's, or product's degree of centrality and structural integration in global value chains? Which are the source countries of foreign value added that are used as an input in the exports by the country of interest? Which countries are the final consumers of domestic value added embodied in the exports by the country of interest? What is a country's performance and what are its main functions in global value chains? Buyer or seller, predominantly headquarters, factory, or assembly location, are domestically owned firms well integrated in global value chains? Through which channels and in which sectors do domestic value added products and services contribute most to the country's gross exports? Does the position, upstream downstream, of the countries and sectors' participation in global value chains matter for domestic value added and growth of domestic value added? What is the impact of global value chain participation on task trade, goods and services, and the factors of production, such as workers, ideas, and investments? Is global value chain participation creating positive effects and spillovers to the domestic economy? Part 2 assesses a country's global value chain participation through three types of measures. 1. Global value chain participation measures, by country and sector, including trade and value added. 2. Network analysis of international trade. 3. Firm-level measures of direct links in global value chains. Global value chain participation measures differentiate between buyer and seller-related measures and combine those measures to assess countries' overall global value chain participation. Growing global value chain participation on the buying side indicates that a country's exports increasingly rely on intermediate imports. Growing global value chain participation on the selling side indicates a country's growth in domestic value added caused by own or third country exports. So various measures drawing on trade and value added data estimate the source of value, domestic or foreign, by country and industry, that is added in goods and services produced for export or final demand. Emphasis is placed on how value addition from gross exports has changed over time and how it is linked to the country's participation in global value chains. Meanwhile, the narrow view of whether a country captures a growing share of the value of exports is dismissed, as it misses the key benefit of growth of domestic value added, in levels, originating from global value chains. Positive changes in foreign sourcing are associated with positive changes in the per capita domestic value added in exports, which suggests that greater use of foreign inputs is complementary to growing per capita domestic value added in exports. Network metrics typically focus on a country's gross trade, trade in value added, trade in parts and components, or other groupings of trade flows that proxy for global value chain trade. The metrics can be computed for overall trade, individual sectors, or individual products in three ways. First, there are several indicators that examine a country's centrality and structural integration in global value chains. Second, the Network Trade Index is an improved measure of assessing a country's trade openness overall. Santoni and Taglioni 2015, its openness in a sector, or its trade of an individual product relative to peers. The index accounts not only for direct trade relationships with partner countries, but also for the interactions of the countries with their partners, in an iterative process that covers the entire network. Third, bilateral network relations can be visualized as a world map of proxies for vertical trade networks. In this context, concepts such as minimal spanning trees visually identify the trade partners with the strongest or most relevant links, according to a chosen parameter. Overall, network analysis helps to capture heterogeneity between the individual nodes in the networks, for example, countries or combinations of countries and sectors, or countries and products, and in the links between the nodes. To understand the complex, multidimensional phenomena that characterize global value chains, firm-level measures focusing on direct links in global value chains add more granularity to the analysis. They can be aggregated up to the sector and country levels, but, where data are sufficiently available, they can also be used to look at the dispersion around the average for any given measure of interest. Firm-level survey data directly capture the main actors in a value chain, buyers and suppliers, and allow comparisons of global value chain links across industries or between types of actors, for example, foreign-owned versus domestically-owned firms, or firms of different sizes, in a country or a single industry across countries. The links between buyers and suppliers include multinational corporations and domestic suppliers in a country, domestic final producers and suppliers abroad, and domestic suppliers and buyers abroad. Part 3. Strategic questions and policy options. Global value chain participation does not automatically generate development. Part 3 shows that development requires getting more value added from a country's productive factors, economic upgrading and densification, improving the quality and quantity of those factors, especially labor skills and technological capabilities, redressing market failures, and engineering equitable distribution of opportunities and outcomes, which all add up to social cohesion. All this must occur while reinforcing living standards, including employment, wages, working conditions, economic rights, gender equality, economic security, and protection of the environment, altogether known as social upgrading. The internationalization of production processes helps with very few of those development challenges, but it provides the policy space to address them. The book offers policymakers analytical tools and policy options to formulate a country's global value chain participation strategy, how the country can enter a global value chain and then leverage its position to expand global value chain participation by shifting and improving resources in a way that advances development goals. Formulating a country's global value chain participation strategy includes determining whether a global value chain delivers labor market enhancing outcomes for workers at home. Thinking at the country level brings to the fore constraints such as the supply of various types of labor, skills, and absorptive capacity. Global value chains can create new opportunities on the labor demand side, but supply and demand cannot meet if the supply is missing. That fact emphasizes the importance of embedding national global value chain policies in a broader portfolio of policies aimed at upgrading skills, improving physical and regulatory infrastructure, and enhancing social cohesion. The Strategic Policy Framework in Part 3 focuses on strategies to help low- and middle-income countries maximize their gains from participation in global value chains. To develop an effective and sustainable strategy of global value chain participation, governments must identify key binding constraints and design the necessary policy and regulatory interventions, as well as infrastructure and capacity building, which allow them to achieve distinct objectives and address specific challenges. See Figure 1 in online document. 1. Entering global value chains, attracting foreign investors and facilitating domestic firms' entry into global value chains. 2. Expanding and strengthening global value chain participation, promoting economic upgrading and densification, and strengthening domestic firms' absorptive capacity. 3. Turning global value chain participation into sustainable development, ensuring skill upgrading, social upgrading, and equitable distribution of opportunities and outcomes while promoting environmental sustainability. The goal is to enable policymakers to make informed choices. All in all, global value chains offer a role to play for economies at different levels of development at any point in time. Economies that have in place a supporting environment and well-functioning institutions can, in addition, move along the value chain, strengthen participation, and achieve higher added value in a sustainable way. Therefore, the book raises strategic questions in each of the three focus areas, offers a range of possible answers, and points to critical issues that must be considered. Which form of global value chain participation can a country pursue? How can global value chain tasks be identified? What are the possible risks of global value chain participation? Which forms of governance exist between led firms and suppliers? Which power relations characterize specific global value chains? What are the global value chain transmission channels? Which type of economic upgrading, densification, and social upgrading can countries pursue? Which foreign firm, domestic firm, and country characteristics influence global value chain spillovers? What is the relationship between economic and social upgrading? And is downgrading a possibility? What are the links between social upgrading and cohesion? What benefits do sustainable global value chain participation can originate from environmental regulation? A country that seeks to participate in global value chains must ask which tasks it should focus on and which types of global value chain governance are possible. A country that is already integrated in global value chains must evaluate the risks that could threaten its survival in the value chain, such as becoming more vulnerable to external shocks. By locating various stages of production in countries where production costs are lower, firms decrease the marginal cost of production, but raise other costs by increasing the complexity and uncertainty associated with organizing production across several locations. Changes in this trade-off affect outsourcing and offshoring decisions, and can be heavily influenced by national policy choices. In recent years, some evidence has started to emerge on backshoring activities because of rising costs, intellectual property rights concerns, digitalization of the economy, and changing perceptions about the stability and reliability of global value chains. Countries also need to be aware of the power relations in global value chains between the lead firm and other firms, and the scope for diversifying specific supply chain risk. Because a large part of global value chain integration happens through foreign direct investment, countries must examine whether foreign direct investment leads to positive spillovers for local actors, especially domestic firms and workers. And they must know about possible factors at the foreign investor, domestic firm, and national and institutional levels that could, positively or negatively, mediate such benefits. Countries also have to decide which type of economic upgrading, product, functional, or intersector, densification, and social upgrading, employment, wages, or labor standards, they want to pursue, and assess the relevance of implementing climate, smart policies and infrastructure in their global value chain integration strategies. Finally, policy options are proposed for each of the three focus areas. 1. Which policies support global value chain entry? 2. How can policies influence the expansion and strengthening of global value chain participation? 3. Which policies help turn global value chain participation into sustainable development? To guide policymakers in prioritizing policies, Part 3 lists performance indicators that can be used to identify the most important challenges that a country must address. See Table 0. One online document which presents selected performance indicators of those described in Part 3. For illustration, governments that seek to join global value chains have to create 1. World-class global value chain links and 2. A world-class climate for foreign tangible and intangible assets. The first item requires attracting the right foreign investors and improving connectivity to international markets. The second requires assets protection and high-quality infrastructure and services. The ease of doing business indicator, for example, can provide an overview of how attractive a country is to foreign investors, especially in its protection of assets. The logistics performance index can help countries assess how well they fare on connectivity to international markets and border efficiency. The Logistics Performance Index can also help in examining the quality of a country's infrastructure and services. To expand and strengthen a country's global value chain participation, policymakers must focus on strengthening existing global value chain local economy links, as well as the absorptive capacity of local actors, to help them maximize the benefits from global value chain spillovers. Absorptive capacity includes innovation capacity, which, for example, could be measured by research and development intensity. Turning global value chain participation into sustainable development also means creating a world-class workforce with policies that promote skill development, social upgrading, and equitable distribution of opportunities and outcomes, and implementing climate-smart policies and infrastructure. Performance indicators include, but are not limited to, education, wage, and employment statistics, as well as indicators on labor standards, access to information, anti-discrimination laws and rights, and social insurance and assistance. Part 4, Country Engagement to complement the content of Parts 1 to 3. Part 4 offers guidelines to engage with country stakeholders for implementing a national strategy to achieve global value chain-led development. The odds of success in global value chains are affected by policy and its implementation in a wide range of influencing areas. Part 4 is intended to bring attention to the synergies between the various areas of policy and help support countries' efforts to identify the necessary reforms to trigger a virtuous cycle of reform, global value chain entry and upgrading, development, The following are important recommendations and lessons learned for interventions at the country level that the World Bank Group experience of working with countries across the globe suggests, comma, the creation of synergies on the ground requires multiple interventions, advisory, analytics, financing, advocacy, and long-lasting engagement. Policy advice supporting global value chain-based growth models requires sound analytics, evidence, and data. It also requires 360-degree assessment of the competitiveness of a country's economy in its entirety and drilling down to specific sectors, global value chains, tasks, and activities to identify, prepare, and inform all interventions. Interventions need to build on analytical foundations and follow well-targeted and action-bound action plans, but they do not need to follow a standard sequence or timeline abstracting from country-specific and context-specific conditions. Coordination, information sharing, and leveraging synergies between different interventions are important. Coordination demands are high within government agencies, global value chain stakeholders, and donor partners. A participative approach, with alignment on and ownership of the agenda by all stakeholders, is critical. Effective stakeholder engagement mechanisms are a central anchor for continued, long-lasting results, but are often the least funded. Network effects and positive spillovers from global value chain participation across sectors, based on integrated solution packages, are achievable over time. Dynamic learning, replication, and scale-up can be fostered through global and cross-country platforms. A shared vision and a common understanding of the project goals and objectives between implementing teams, local and international stakeholders, and other development partners are important for success. The rest of Part 4 shares World Bank Group experience in leveraging the combination of quantitative, desk-based analysis, fieldwork, and in-country capacity building to produce sound, country-specific diagnostics. References. Antris, Paul 2015. Global Production, Firms, Contracts, and Trade Structure. Princeton, NJ, Princeton University Press. Baldwin, Richard, and Javier Lopez Gonzalez 2013. Supply Chain Trade, A Portrait of Global Patterns and Several Testable Hypotheses, NBER Working Paper 18957. National Bureau of Economic Research, Cambridge, M.A. Gomez Mera, Laura, Thomas Kenyon, Yadam Margulet, Josu Guilherme Rice, and Gonzalo Varela, 2015. New Voices in Investment, A Survey of Investors from Emerging Countries, Washington, D.C., World Bank, Medler, Ann, and Anthony Williams 2011. The Rise of the Micro-Multinational, How Freelancers and Technology-Savvy Startups Are Driving Growth, Jobs and Innovation, Policy Brief, Lisbon Council, Brussels, Belgium, Santoni, Gianluca, and Aria Taglioni 2015. Networks and Structural Integration in Global Value Chains, In the Age of Global Value Chains, edited by Juan Amador and Filippo Di Mauro, Washington, D.C., Center for Economic and Policy Research.